Let's look at a few bullet points that we need to understand this concept. First of all, if we think about conductive electricity, that is, the reason this light is on is because there's a wire that is carrying electrons. That's called conductive electricity. But in a liquid, we have a different circumstance. We have the possibility for a liquid to be an electron donor or an electron stealer. And so one uses a sophisticated voltmeter called a pH meter, and you put it in the liquid and it will give you a readout in millivolts. And by convention, if it's an electron donor, you put a minus sign in front of the voltage, and as an electron stealer, you put a plus sign in front of it. So cells are designed to run at minus 25 millivolts of electron donor, and if a cell gets worn out or gets injured, then you need minus 50 millivolts to make a new one. So the body has several different battery systems that provide the voltage necessary for cells to function and for cells to repair themselves. And as I'll show you, also to help protect themselves from various infectious diseases. So the first bullet point is to understand that pH and voltage in a liquid are synonyms. And it's much easier to get your mind around it if instead of talking in pH numbers, you're talking in millivolts. The next thing to understand is that voltage is necessary to hold, to transfer and to hold oxygen in a cell. So if you read about a liquid, particularly water, you'll find that one of the things that controls the amount of oxygen that will dissolve in a liquid is the voltage. Now there are other things like temperature, etc., but if you take a glass of water and you put a tube in it and you start bubbling oxygen in, the amount of oxygen that will dissolve is dictated primarily by the voltage. So if I raise the voltage of the water, more oxygen goes into solution. If I lower the voltage in the water, oxygen comes out of solution and goes away. Well, our cells are 90% water. So if you lose the voltage in your cell, the oxygen's going to go away. So oxygen is critical because oxygen controls a lot of the things that happens in the cell. In addition to the energy of the voltage, oxygen is very important as well. So when oxygen drops, one of the things that happens is things get painful. So chronic pain is caused primarily by there being lack of oxygen, or when you have lack of voltage, things are acidic, and the acidic things make things hurt, but also primarily the lack of oxygen. Another thing that happens is that the efficiency of the cell drops. So we, inside our cell, we have a rechargeable battery system called ADP, ATP. When it's charged up, it's ATP. When it's discharged, it's ADP. And then we have a battery charger called the Krebs cycle. So for every unit of fat you put into the battery charger, if oxygen's available, you get enough electrons to charge up 38 of those batteries. But if oxygen's unavailable or low, for every unit of fat you put into the charger, you only get enough electrons to charge up two batteries. So it's like having a car that goes from 38 miles a gallon to 2 miles a gallon. It's very inefficient. And then the next thing that happens is that as oxygen and voltage drop more and more, various infectious organisms can start having their way with you. And I'll discuss the mechanism of that in a moment. But the point is that there are many organisms inside the body and outside the body that can cause damage to the body. And most of those can only function where oxygen levels are low. So that's called anaerobic. So most of the bugs that harm the body can only live in low levels of oxygen, which by definition is an acidic or low pH or low voltage. So low voltage creates the environment where you have low oxygen, which creates the environment where bugs can have their way with you. And they always show up. So again, we're back to voltage being the controlling mechanism. Now, one of the things that happens as the voltage and the oxygen gets reduced is that bacteria lose their cell membranes and become what Lida Mattman, a researcher in Chicago, called cell wall deficient organisms or stealth pathogens. So the issue is when a bacteria loses its cell wall, antibiotics don't work because antibiotics primarily work against cell membranes. And so as voltage and oxygen drops, those disappear. So you can give all the antibiotics you want, they don't do anything, except it's been shown that if you want to grow these cell wall deficient organisms in a culture, the only way you can make them grow is to add antibiotics to the culture. So when you start giving antibiotics to someone with low voltage and low oxygen, you can actually make it worse. And that's not generally known, although it's been in the literature for many years. Now, the other interesting bullet point is that the only ways you can get rid of these stealth pathogens is to raise the voltage, which raises the oxygen, or if you can figure out a way to put oxygen into the tissue at higher levels, that puts them back to sleep or destroys them. And or the other way of doing it is what's called oxidative therapies. And of course, oxidative therapies, which is ozone, hydrogen peroxide, chlorine dioxide, and vitamin C works in a very similar way. Then all of those are involved with the ability to provide more oxygen in the tissue. Now, what I hope is that I've been able to make clear enough is that the root cause of all of this failing is losing voltage, because voltage is the primary controller of everything that goes on in the body. So with the voltage drops, oxygen drop, all kinds of infections show up and then have their way with you. Now, there's been some conversation recently about the role of various medications in an effort to destroy viruses or at least stop their ability to duplicate. So work has been recently published from Stanford Medical School about the role of a very old, 1944, I think was the beginning, of a drug that has been used for malaria. It's been used for lupus and for arthritis since the 1940s. And so one of the things that is, if you look at how that drug works, is that it raises intracellular pH. Or another way of saying exactly the same thing is that drug increases intracellular voltage. And so the other bullet point is viruses cannot duplicate themselves unless the voltage inside the cell is low. So viruses, because they're not like bacteria, which has a more complete organism, it's basically RNA and not the whole DNA and everything a bacteria has, they have to be inside of cell to duplicate. And if they get into a cell, which is difficult for them to do when the voltage is normal, it blocks their ability to duplicate. Let me say it one more time because it's so important. The way these drugs work is they increase intracellular voltage, which stops viruses from duplicating, and thus the virus cannot make more of itself and eventually just dies. And that's the way you block its ability to infect more and more people. And so again, what the literature clearly shows us is that intracellular voltage, or the voltage of every cell in the body, is the root of whether we are sick or well. It's the root of whether we're dead or alive. And so when we want to get down to the basics of everything and we want people to be healthy, we simply have to address what's the voltage in every organ system in the body. Now, I didn't really mention it in the beginning, but it's perhaps worth doing at this stage in the conversation, and that is that our muscles are piezoelectric. So what does that mean? If you take any substance and you distort it and it emits electrons, that's called piezoelectricity. So anytime I move my muscles, I'm generating electrons. But our muscles are also rechargeable batteries. And so exercise, charges up our muscle battery packs. And our muscles are stacked one on top of each other like stacking batteries in a flashlight to form a power pack and surrounded by a common sheath of what's called fascia, which is the body's wiring system to carry the voltage every place in the body. And a stack of muscle batteries, what's been called an acupuncture meridian. So if you have an acupuncture meridian that loses its ability to store voltage, then whatever organs it powers will be the organs where the voltage drops, and those are the organs that are going to end up not having the 25 millivolts it takes to work, and it doesn't have the 50 millivolts to repair itself, and it doesn't have, obviously, the voltage to inhibit infections. So one of the important things to understand about a rechargeable battery is this: if this is a battery and it's got a plus and a minus, if you take and discharge that battery all the way to zero, it flips itself upside down. Well, a battery upside down won't take a charge no matter what you do. So once you have a muscle battery pack that's flipped itself upside down, anything you do may make you feel a little better because you've inserted some electrons that it can't provide, but you very quickly use those up and you're right back where you started. So critical to getting the body back to its normal physiology is turning that battery back up like so, which you can do with scalar energy. Scalar energy will correct the polarity of the battery. Now, once you turn it back up, it's still discharged, so you have to use electromagnetic energy to charge it back up. And now you have a battery pack that allows the cells to go back and do the things they were designed to do. Do their job, make new ones to do their job. And of course, you can't ignore the nutrition piece, because when you're making new cells, you have to have all the parts that it takes to make those cells. And you can't just do little bits and pieces. You have to have everything it takes to make a cell. And then if there are any other toxins hanging around, you got to deal with those. But basically, what I've hoped to help you understand is that no matter whether you're in a season between fall and spring every year where we're prone to have infectious diseases, or whether you're just feeling bad all the time, you just are tired all the time. Tired all the time means that one or more of your battery packs has lost its charge. And so, fortunately, we now understand how to measure the voltage in every circuit. And then there are five things that make it lose its ability to hold a charge: not enough thyroid hormone, a scar across its wiring system, a dental infection, because every circuit goes through specific teeth in this, and decay in a tooth acts like a resistor and drops the voltage, emotional baggage, which blocks the circuit, and other toxins. So whether those toxins be microbial, bacteria, viruses and fungus, or whether it's pesticides or heavy metals, or the list of toxins goes on, all of those things are electron stealers and can drop the voltage. And if you address all of those, you can get the battery pack back to its original function. When you get the voltage up, oxygen comes up. When the oxygen comes up, all the bugs go to sleep, and there you go. There you go. It's all about healing this voltage. And that's all I can say about that.